And there we go for tonight. Well, I think this one has to be finished, so I have to do it. Well, let's have a look first at this Omega. Nice Omega. Full gold. And we have to do a full revision. Well, what do we have here? Well, at least we know it's gold. Not too much to see, so just open it first. Let's have a look what we have to do tonight. I think we are going to replace this plexiglass. That's just nasty. So clean it and make it nice again. Let's have a look at the movement. I still haven't seen it. Something interesting about this Omega, if you watch from here, you can see the cannon pinion and hour wheel is not in the middle of the dial. So the dial feet are not straight anymore, but slightly bent. And this is, well, we have to adapt it anyway, but this is such a common source of problems with quartz movements, because quartz is using a very small amount of energy to move the hands. So if the inside of the hand is just touching the inside of the dial, creates all kinds of problems. First I'm going to remove the dial, and after that we'll have a good look at the movement. I would presume there was a dial feet screw there and there. Here it is. I thought, please don't let it be glued in place, because that is quite horrible. Well, now the movement. You see, I think there's been some moisture, especially underneath here. This is interesting, what is over there. We'll have a look in a moment. As in all vintage Omegas, no small spring on the hour wheel. If you find here a spring over the hour wheel, well, it's probably been put there with a less experienced watchmaker. Might be grease. There's a lot of sideways play in there. Let's have a look. There's some play, but not that horrible. That just looks horrible. Oh wow, look at it. Is it a scratch, or I think it's just from there all over? It's huge. First I'm going to remove the cannon pinion. This tool is not for removing a cannon pinion, But now it's so small, and you can just apply a tiny bit of pressure while removing it. Well, what kind of movement is it? It's a 620. There's some play over there. What do we think of the balance spring? Here it's a bit, no, there it's a bit high on top. The space between windings on that side is a bit less than over there. So the whole spring should be a tiny bit more like that. Should be okay. What do we think of the shock system? I think it's been a while it's seen some lubrication. Imon Kretsch, it hardly expands at the top. Usually very well spotted, Imon Kretsch. But with the timing pins, those are the timing, that's the stud, that's the end of the balance spring. These are the timing pins, and usually if the timing pins are at the bottom, the spring breathes a bit like this. So on the side of the timing pins, it's usually a bit stationary, and on the other side there's more breathing space. You see this spring breathing like this. That means the center of gravity is from the balance wheel itself. It's moving every single time. It's a virtual center of gravity, because the balance is moving. So far so good. The balance spring is breathing, otherwise the balance wheel shouldn't be moving, isn't moving. So the center of gravity is a virtual one, because the spring is moving like this. And that is important for the accuracy. It has been such a long time since there's been any lubrication in there. Now first I'd like to make sure there's no power on the barrel. The power of the barrel is released, so oh wow, I'm just pushing slightly with my finger on the crown. And here is a huge amount of play there, but more important, here, just look right in between there. I'm just pushing, slightly turning the crown. And you see it tilting, but towards this center wheel over here. You see this bit here coming, tilting upwards against the center wheel. So that is the reason why this watch wasn't running so well, and the lack of lubrication and maintenance. I think at first I removed the ratchet wheel. Because now I'm intrigued about the amount of play in that bearing. Oh dear, look at this. I didn't expect that. Did you? The rust doesn't really stick at the bridge. But it is rust from the steel ratchet wheel. It's a very particular place for just there for the rust to exist. And now you can see not a single watch or movement is straightforward. Never. And now you can see this one over here isn't reflecting the light at the same time. You see that? So that means the screw head is not level. It's a bit like this.
Yeah.
So maybe it's over tightened and the screw head is a bit like this. So we'll have to be extra careful with this screw because it might be just a bit like this and could break. So let's remove the probably dodgy screw. And I think we're going to replace that one. With this very small movement and kind of heavy balance wheel, I like to lift the balance wheel and support the wheel with an oiler. So not the complete weight of the balance wheel is pulling at a balance spring. So when removing the balance wheel, I like to support it with an oiler underneath to lift it out. It looks horrible, but then again, we're still gently doing the disassembly. Oh, thank you so much, Per. That's nice. Well, here you can see the moisture in the pallet fork. Do you see the rings? That is actual moisture residue. Okay, now I would like to remove the bridge over here and see what's underneath. Gently lift the bridge. Could be worse. That's an extreme long pivot for the escape wheel. It just looks out of proportion. Cool. I Well, here we have to be very careful. We have to be very careful here with this small yoke spring. There we go. Yeah. I use an oiler because I really don't want to make any scratches over there. This just looks horrible. Well, there's the complete ladies' movement from 1969. For me, that's it tonight. My name is Carl Slaap. I'm a watchmaker here in the Netherlands, about 50 kilometers north of Amsterdam. And from Richard and Owen, hope to see you soon. We do this stream once a week, every Tuesday. 8:30 p.m. And hope to see you soon.